glad you could come along.
I put a spell on you.
Grid is live. Initiate light cycle battle.
Welcome, foolish mortals.
For a safe trip, remain seated, keeping your hands, arms, feet, and legs inside the cabin. Be sure to watch your children, and no smoking, please.
Welcome to the Pirates and Princesses podcast.
We're a different kind of Disney podcast. We do it our way.
We talk about Disney parks, Disney movies, TV, video games.
Anything Disney.
I'm your host, Thom Pratt.
And I'm your other host, Kambrea Pratt.
Hey guys, welcome back to Pirates and Princesses. This is Thom. I'm here with Cam.
Hello.
And we're going to talk about Disney and Universal stuff.
Because that's what we do.
That's what we do. So Happy New Year. This is the first podcast of the new year.
Yes, we had a couple weeks off for holiday reasons.
Yeah, the holidays tend to happen about the same time every year.
Yeah, it's weird how that goes.
It is. It must be a coincidence.
I mean, it just happens to be the same time every time.
So... yeah, what are we going
to
talk about?
Well, there's a lot to talk about today. Well, first of all, we got a lot of information about the food that's going to be at the Festival of the Arts. There's the popcorn bucket, the Figment popcorn bucket of infamy is coming back.
Figment popcorn bucket of infamy.
Yes. We have information about some new Disney discounts for Walt Disney World. We're going to talk about Jerry Renner, who was in an accident.
Yeah,
there's lots to talk about today.
All right. So make sure that you subscribe wherever you found this podcast. And this podcast, I guess, is the inaugural podcast of the Web Reef Podcast Network.
Oh, yes.
We're going to have more details about that soon.
Uh-huh.
So, definitely follow us, and we'll have more details about some of the other stuff coming your way this year. So let's talk about this popcorn bucket.
Okay, so last year at the Epcot International Festival of the Arts, they unveiled a Figment popcorn bucket.
Yeah.
And insanity ensued.
Yes.
Like, the line for this thing was longer than rides. It was longer wait for Figment popcorn bucket than it was for, like, Rise of the Resistance or Flight of Passage. It was insane.
Well, at least that tells Disney that there's still demand for Figment.
Yeah, you know, yeah.
That's
fix during an imagination.
Yeah, fix Figment.
And the popcorn bucket ended up going for hundreds of dollars on eBay. So I'm sorry if you paid that. And people were actually even selling drawings of the Figment popcorn bucket and making money. That was for charity, but they were still doing it. And then this year they're doing it again now. But the strap is different. It's the 40th anniversary of Epcot strap.
Oh, okay.
Same bucket, different strap.
Yeah, you think they'd at least do a different bucket, but...
Nope, same bucket. Oh, no, that costs money. We'll just make a new strap. And, you know, if they were smart, they'd sell the strap separately, but they probably won't.
I don't know.
They won't. So there's going to be all these straps on eBay.
So many jokes.
I know, there are.
So many jokes.
So if you overpaid for a Figment popcorn bucket, I am sorry.
Yeah, so... yeah, the popcorn buckets, I never personally got the whole fascination with them. The first time I was aware that there was a demand for popcorn buckets was when they did the AT-AT Walker in Disneyland.
I still wanted one of those. I never got one. We don't have that one. I do have the Haunted Mansion ones that I love. And I do have Figment, thanks to... I got one, and my nephew got one, thanks to one of our writers and a friend of ours.
Yeah, yeah.
And but I'll tell you what I like. The ones in Tokyo are... phenomenal. Like, you can't compare the Tokyo popcorn buckets to the American ones. All their merchandise over there is so much cuter, cooler, and better, and they won't bring it over here. And it angers me.
Well, that's like Universal. They've got all kinds of crazy anime.
They have Sailor Moon popcorn bucket. Yeah. I know. I own it because my husband bought it for me.
Yeah, we got
you. Bought it for me. So, yeah. They have all kinds of amazing things over there, but they don't bring it over here. And so, you want to make money, Disney? Duffy and Friends. At Walt Disney World and Disneyland, I'm telling you.
That's how you make money. So let's talk about, since we're talking about the Festival of the Arts, let's talk about the menus announced.
Yeah, so they have the outdoor studios. They changed the name, kitchens, right. The food. It's the food. So we're going to look at some of those. You can go ahead and read some.
Do I have to read all of these? It's like a lot of stuff to read.
There really isn't that many.
Okay, well, Pop Eats, which is my favorite, they've got the almond frangipane cake again.
Which you love.
Which is my favorite thing at Festival of the Arts. It's like, if I get one thing, it's going to be
that. They also have tomato soup with grilled cheese and tomato soup with pimento cheese, bacon, and fried green tomato.
Tomato soup grilled with tomato, cheese. Bacon, lettuce, tomato, with tomatoes, tomatoes on tomato bread with...
With cheese.
With cheese. Okay. All right.
And then they have drinks.
And of course they do.
So, deconstructed dish. This is where they tear food apart, basically, in pieces. It's what they do. Go ahead.
Okay. So, deconstructed dish near the port of entry. They've got the deconstructed BLT. Which, what do they do? Just throw bacon, lettuce, and tomato on a plate and say, here you go.
It's pork belly, soft poached egg, onion bread pudding, watercress, espuma, and tomato jam.
None of that screams BLT to me. It just looks like a bunch of stuff on a blue plate. Deconstructed French onion soup, beef broth ravioli, Gruyere cream, onion bread pudding, and onion textures. Is it the crunchy onion?
It's the flippin' crunchy onions that you put on, you know, green bean casserole. But we can't call it that because it's Disney, so it's onion textures.
I do like this one, the deconstructed key lime pie, the flexible key lime curd, key lime mousse, graham cracker cake, and meringues. That actually looks kind of good.
That is actually pretty. Then they got some beverages, a deconstructed apple pie a la mode, and a Wicked Weed brewing.
Wicked Weed?
Blank canvas, Belgian blonde, whatever, whip beer, I don't know. That's a lot of words. They got drinks.
They got drinks. Of course they have drinks.
Deco Delights has dulce chocolate mousse with chocolate cremeux and dark chocolate truffle. I only know how to say this because I watch a lot of cooking shows.
Cremeux.
Decadent, was it Valerona cake?
I don't know.
With dark chocolate mousse, chocolate brownie, and cassis mousse.
Chocolate, more chocolate, and for like $12 for a little tiny piece of chocolate at Disney.
Pretty much.
You're too fat, so you can't have a bigger slice.
Well, that's right. We have to shrink it. But the prices go up. Orange mousse with lemon cake and raspberry meringues. Then they got drinks. Yeah, you're right. We can't read all these.
No.
The Craftsman Courtyard has beef Wellington and mussels. And then they have a hot dog thing at Refreshment Outpost. Pastoral Palette has some stuff. They're going to have Artist Table. You can go out to piratesandprincesses.net and see all this.
Yeah, I think that's a better... I mean, we...
I was going to, but then I'm like, no.
We used to read, like, all the menus on the food stuff, and then kind of like, but people can't see the pictures.
I ain't got time for that.
Yeah, we ain't got time for that. There's lots of food.
But Bronte and Vivito, let me see. We have Gourmet Landscapes. Oh, they had, like, Pop Eats. Refreshment Port.
Yeah, I mean, we talked about the French bean cake. That's all I care about.
Modern.
So I don't... Oh, that was kind of cool. They have a rainbow cake and a Pop-Tart. The Pop-Tarts are actually good.
Inspiration Station at the Odyssey. Art, food, and little sparks of magic. And those are very, very cute. Wait.
They have Skittles.
The freeze-dried Skittles on top.
Freeze-dried Skittles on
top.
Our
friends make freeze-dried food, and freeze-dried Skittles are amazing. Interesting. Connections interesting. Cafe. The Art de Cuisine Francaise. Well,
what's the purple thing on the plate? That is...
The purple thing on the plate? I'm not sure. Is it a...
I can't pronounce it.
I think it's a Malais filet de betterville au herbe et noir de cajou, something like that.
Oh, that sounds dirty.
Plant-based Napoleon with beets, cashew, herb filling, pepper and pine nut sauce, and balsamic vinegar, caviar.
Hey, baby, I've always wanted to try noir de cajou. You down for that? I'll buy you some drinks at Epcot and we'll...
What trick around the world? El Artista Habriento. I don't speak Spanish. Goshiki, the Painted Panda, the Art de Mangier.
I don't know.
Funnel cake.
Okay, I can do that. I can do funnel cake.
Things and coffee. And there's coffee.
The funnel cake looks good.
I'll just be like, give me one of those green things and call it a day.
Yeah, there you go.
You know, this is kind of cool. It looks like a palette, and they have like something in the middle, and then they have like different sauces, I think, around it. So I think it's flash fried breaded fresh mozzarella with artist palette condiments, and you can try the different sauces.
Okay.
It's funny because it's literally in one of the artist palettes that I use to teach art kids.
Yeah, yeah.
They have these little palettes like in your art class in high school or elementary school, the little round ones. It looks like that. So that was kind of cool.
That is kind of cool. So that is some of the food coming. So we got a lot of things to talk about.
I forgot about that.
Let's get some bad news. A couple bad news stories out of the way. Jeremy Renner was in an accident.
Yeah. Apparently he got run over by his snowplow.
Yeah.
And then, according to the mayor of the area, he was helping a stranded motorist when it happened. So they had a bad snowstorm, and I think they said that he was helping somebody else, and then it ran over. The safety feature didn't work, and it ran over his leg and part of his abdomen or chest, because that's why he had to have surgery on his leg and his chest.
Yeah, it's. He said he feels pretty messed up, but he posted something on Instagram today. They were giving him like a head massage or something. I don't know.
Oh, did he? I didn't see it.
So he said he's getting a spa day. But yeah, he did. He got hurt trying to help somebody else out. This was in, he lives in the Reno area, and they got a bunch of snow over the weekend.
And people, like the mayor was saying, he's always doing things to help others in the area. Like that's where his house is, and he always is, you know, he's working with the volunteer fire department. He's trying to be a volunteer firefighter. He's been doing all kinds of stuff. And he also has a show coming, I think Disney Plus, called Renovations.
Oh, cool.
Because he does his own, like, building and stuff like that too. Yeah. So, you know.
Yeah, things could have gone a lot worse.
Thank God it didn't.
Thankfully, he's okay. So there.
Well, we don't know if he's okay, but he's okay-ish. Still with us.
He's still with us. He seems like he's better than he was.
He seems like he has good spirits, though. So that's good.
Bad news. Barbara Walters passed away on New Year's Eve, and she was 93 years old.
That's like when we had
Betty White.
Yeah, before New Year's, didn't she die before New Year's too?
It's like 2022 had to claim one more.
Always. One of the There's always one at the end. Yes, I saw that. Too, was that at the end of last year or beginning of this year?
That was the end of this year. Yeah, it was one of the Pointer Sisters.
Or last year. 2022.
What year are we on?
This, where am I? Like Who
last
am I?
Week. Last week was last year. That's crazy. Yeah, so it would have been right before the new year, yes. Which would have been last year. I just had to think about that a little bit, because now I got to figure out, I got to write 2023 on all the checks now. And
yeah, I haven't had to write one yet, thank goodness, because I'll probably screw it up.
Anyway, 93 years old. And of course, you know, she was on The View. She was, you know, historic journalistic figure.
One of the first women to get to be able to do a lot of things in journalism.
Yes, she did a lot of things. So RIP Barbara Walters.
She got a lot of people to cry.
She did it again
at the end of the year.
She did. So speaking of making people cry, what's this about Disney cracking down on IP infringing merchandise sellers?
Okay, so I'm like one explaining everything.
Yeah, because I don't know what's going on anymore.
So Disney has filed a lawsuit against a Kissimmee-based retailer, I want to call it. They basically sell on Etsy and some other websites, and they have the Secret Disney Group and Popsella Marketplace. Mm-hmm. And I guess Disney has given them several cease and desist letters because they're actually using the Disney IP characters on, like, printing them on the masks or printing them on the things, like the images. No. And they've gotten cease and desist letters a couple times, and they didn't stop. So now they filed a lawsuit against them.
Mm-mm.
That's part of it. The other part is I'm hearing, because I used to sell on Etsy and stuff, and I'm in different groups, and I'm hearing that Etsy sellers are having warnings given to them, or things are being taken down on Etsy that have Disney stuff, because I think Etsy's afraid Disney's going to sue them. So their knee-jerk reaction is to, you know, start taking people's stuff down. People are saying that Disney's threatening other people with lawsuits. I haven't seen that. I'm just telling you what people are saying.
They look, there's a controversy around that, because Disney has a tendency to borrow inspiration from Etsy. And
I've seen shirts on Etsy, and then they end up on shirts at Disney not long after.
Yeah, and this has happened repeatedly. Unfortunately, I don't think there's much recourse, that, you know, artists don't have much recourse if they're using Disney-owned characters, but Disney's kind of like, hey, thanks for that.
Right. Well, I wonder, Disney's really cracking down on this, you know, and they're those people. Are they going to come after the convention people?
Eventually, I think they will.
Because for those who don't understand, if you go to conventions, there is a lot of art prints that are sold. And a lot of them are characters owned by Disney.
Yes.
Some of them are owned by Warner Brothers, you know, that kind of thing, the superheroes and that and so forth. And Disney has a license with some artists where, you know, they're allowed to sell prints of their work because they work with Disney and Disney gets a cut. But there's a lot of people who make their own prints. And some of them are making, like, six figures selling prints at conventions or selling them to other people to sell at conventions. And I think Disney's going to start... I wouldn't be surprised. They're mad about Etsy seller making $20 on something. I don't think they're going to like it. Someone's making thousands and thousands of dollars selling prints.
No. There have been issues with that. You know, people doing Marvel and Star Wars stuff, but it's usually the mega sellers.
Mm-hmm.
And a lot of times they'll work out a licensing deal with the artist, especially if they work officially on Lucasfilm.
Well, yeah, that's what I'm talking about. They're allowed to.
Yeah. It hasn't been a big deal yet because the volume, I guess, of sales and the amount of money that Disney would recover isn't worth the legal fees, as I understand it. But I think eventually I could see them being like, hey, if you want us to, like San Diego, I could see it. Like, if you want us to actually come to Hall H and give our presentation, you need to stop anybody from selling bootleg merchandise.
They're not supposed to, but conventions usually
No, they're not supposed to.
Don't bother. You know, everybody is doing it, so they don't bother. But I'm saying, if they're going to start cracking down on little sellers on Etsy. And what also I found interesting was, Disney is notorious for taking other people's stuff. Like, that Enchanted Tiki Room drummer 3D printed. If you can see the article on Pirates and Princesses, there was a guy, and the video's gone on TikTok, so I think he must have worked something out. But he had done a 3D render, like of a, you could 3D print your own little drummer, and he was giving it away for free. Well, when they had their 50th anniversary, you know, statue of the drummer, it was the exact same piece. It was down to, like, he had little marks where he, and these are things that there's no way that he randomly would have put them in the same place. It wasn't like it was on the actual statue and it matched up. They matched, which means that somebody somewhere stole his design and blew it up. Disney, I don't know if they did anything about it, but there was one instance. Another instance, they went after somebody on Redbubble because they had a low L-O-W-K-E-Y shirt, and they're trying to trademark Loki, but they can't because you can't own a Norse god. They also tried to trademark Day of the Dead before Coco, and that didn't work out for them either.
Yeah, Disney's crazy when it comes to that kind of stuff. I mean, they pretty much just kind of spray and pray. I think they've got so much money invested in legal that they just kind of throw, you know, just throw the stuff out there and see if they can get away with it.
But, well, I think what they're going to do is they're just going to go after like a high profile one like this. Yes. And then you, hopefully that this scares enough people into taking their stuff down is what I think they're hoping for.
Yeah, no, I could see them doing that. I definitely could see them doing that. But yeah, I mean, Etsy's getting kind of dicey now anyway. You have any, you know, merchandise that's, you know, IP that even if it's not even directly, you know, lifting from the rights holder, they'll shut you down.
Well, so it was Redbubble. I was thinking about that one. Yeah. There's a person who had a webcomic called Arcane. It had nothing to do with the League of Legends Arcane. And I think theirs was out before they had the show and everything for Arcane. Somebody from the game company, I guess, went and struck it and because it had the word Arcane in it. Well, here's the thing. It had nothing to do with their property, and you cannot trademark the word Arcane by itself. Like, you can trademark it something in relation to your product only, but that you don't own that word. Like, we can, you know, trademark, you know, something, in, but if it has the word, like, TV in it or something, like, you can't own the word TV, you know? So that's the thing. And they tried, and the person got it back, but they had to get a whole bunch of help from YouTubers and stuff to get attention to get it back.
I think what happens a lot of times is they hire these third-party law firms to go out and just flag everything that could potentially be a problem. And they do that because they're probably getting paid per, you know, like, oh, look how much we saved you. We flagged, you know, 300 people this month and show all this, you know, merch down. But they're not educated enough to realize what, you know, what is and what is not actually the company's IP.
Right.
Yeah. And this happens a lot with, you know, music and stuff like that too.
Before we move on, I just want to say real quick, I remember when the Baby Yoda came out, they didn't have any merch for it. A bunch of people were making merchandise on Etsy and different places were selling Baby Yoda merchandise. And some of the different designs that you saw, like, you know, there's like that he's sleepy, something he attack or whatever. A lot of those, they ended up, I saw almost identical things come out from Disney not long after.
Oh, yeah.
And I was like, are you kidding me?
Yeah.
Like, you know, come on.
I think it's Disney uses Etsy just like they use the fan community to kind of as unpaid R&D.
Yeah. It's like, come on.
If something's really popular, then they're going to be like, yep, that's a great
but
idea.
But it was like straight up the same thing. And I was like, you know, at least try.
Yeah, so let's see here. What's another rumor we got? Man, we got a lot of ground to cover here. Just in the last week or two, there's been a lot of news.
You can talk about this one because, you know, the rumor's been around for a while, but now there might be some truth to it.
Yeah, the rumor is that Rock and Roller Coaster at some point in time is going to get a retheme. It is getting a little long in the tooth, but what might expedite that is that Steven Tyler from Aerosmith is in trouble now because he had a relationship with an underage girl back in the 70s, and for some reason she decided to sue now.
I know why, because you're hearing about with Romeo and Juliet and stuff too. California, they had a thing that you had to have all these lawsuits in by December 31st, 2022.
Okay.
If you're going to sue over this kind of stuff, it had to be in by then.
Okay, so that makes sense. So, yes, again, everybody knew that he had this fling with this girl back then. It went for 40, 50 years. You didn't hear anything about it. Now, all of a sudden, he's being sued. And Like 2 days before the lawsuit was announced, Disney decided
They suddenly announced this is they're closing it down for refurbishment for several months.
Disney suddenly decided they were going to close down Rock and Roller Coaster for refurbishment. Probably, I mean, if I had to guess, it was unannounced. If I had to guess, I'd say to get ahead of any potential cancel culture backlash.
It's possible. I mean, it's weird timing. I mean, the day before that it hits the public that, you know, this lawsuit's filed.
Right.
Disney, you know, out of nowhere says that they're going to shut down the Rock and Roller Coaster for several months.
But then the flip side is, you know, the entire time during the Johnny Depp debacle, they didn't get rid of Captain Jack
right.
and the ride.
So it might be, it could just be that they're refreshing it and updating stuff. I mean, we don't know. But there's been a rumor for a while they were going to change it because their contract with Aerosmith was up, I guess. And it's not a new rumor by any means.
No.
But it came out of nowhere. Like, suddenly, we're shutting it down for several months. Four to 8 months, depending.
Yeah, 4 to 8 months to find a replacement.
And then we've had something shut down for a few months, too. And then, we're extending the, you know.
Yeah.
So that's, like, it could extend. If they decide they're going to change it now, there's bad press with it, they might hold it down longer.
You know, the upside to this is, right? The upside is they can make a lot more money on Genie Plus because all the other attractions are going to be a lot busier.
That's true.
You know, because every time they shut down one of their major attractions, everything else.
I thought you were going to say the upside was they're going to fix the headrest. Because if you ride that ride, you come out the biggest headache because your head just bangs against the sides of those headrests. If you've ridden it, you know what I'm talking about.
Yeah, I have back issues.
You would never rode it, so you don't know what I'm talking about.
No, I can't ride it.
I know, but I'm saying people who have ridden it know what I mean.
Yeah, it's funny because our daughter, you know, she's in the roller coaster. She likes roller coasters and she was okay to ride it because she'd ridden the Incredicoaster. And
she won't ride it again.
She won't ride that again. She won't ride Rock and Roller Coaster again.
No. And she won't ride Tower of Terror again.
No. Not Tower of Terror, no. Nope. Hard pass. Anyway.
I'll ride all of them again.
Yeah. I'm at the point where I'm like, I mean, I was never big into roller coasters anyway, but even like rides that spin now, I'm kind of getting like, getting old.
I'll ride it, but I am getting to the place where I'm just like,
So let's talk about discounts if you want to go to Disney.
All right, go ahead.
Sounds like some desperation going on.
There are some discounts, and they're going to be from spring to summer. And there is a up to $750 Disney dining card. We're going to talk about that too. But before that, there is a basic 25% off one for everyone.
Yeah, so there's been some talk about this, and we've actually had some people comment on the blog or on different videos. You know, the booking situation right now with Disney doesn't seem to be very good. There are people in the UK actually making comments that they're not getting the bookings they're expecting to get. A lot of people probably afraid of the economy going south. Mm-hmm. Disney's price hikes. There have been a lot of stories in the media about how Disney is no longer a good value, that they're gouging their customers, and people are going to open out. They're going to open out.
They like, I think it was really interesting. The one website, what was it? The one that you...
Oh, I think Fodor's. I think it was one of the travel
yeah,
sites.
It was what it was. And they were saying, and I thought this was a valid point, that, you know, when you chase away the middle-class families, you price that so they can't go, you're left with the people with a lot of money. And that's great that you're chasing these whales and you want them to come in. But when they're paying that much money and they can go anywhere, if they're coming to you, they expect primo, top of the line. They're not going to be okay with, hey, the boats at Small World look like garbage and, you know, stuff sinking and there's dirt and garbage everywhere and the bathrooms aren't clean. I mean, even if you have a tour guide, you still have to use the bathrooms, right?
Mm-hmm.
So I'm like, they're not going to accept it either.
No. And yeah, they're going to expect a lot more. And you know, we've got the hotels creeping up in price. The
tickets keep up in price.
Everything's creeping up. It's like, what, $900 and some dollars a night for the Contemporary, the
Incredibles.
Yeah, it was like $988 or something like that. That's
not
insane.
Worth it.
No. You can go to a much, much nicer hotel for a lot less money.
That seems awfully high.
But let's talk about some of these other deals. You know more about the deals than I do, so.
Okay, well, let's talk about the other one first because you had it pulled up. So this is for everyone. Guests can stay. You can get 25% off, up to 25% off, select Disney World Resort hotels for spring and summer. These hotel deals are going to run from March 1st to March 31st, which is over spring break, surprisingly, and April 10th through July 10th. So it's right after Easter to July 10th. So if July 4th is counted in there.
Hmm.
Also interesting.
Yeah, that is because usually with these discounts, Disney only discounts slow times of the year. I mean, they'll discount like, you know, February or, you know, the beginning of September or something like that. But July 4th, that's...
Yeah, and spring break.
In spring break?
Yeah, that tells me a lot.
That's not a good sign.
So, at some of the resorts, these ones here listed, Boulder Ridge Villas, Copper Creek Villas, Disney Animal Kingdom Lodge, Beach Club, Boardwalk Inn, Boardwalk Villas, Grand Floridian Resort, Old Key West, Polynesian Village, Riviera, Saratoga Springs, Wilderness Lodge, and Yacht Club. If you go between April 10th and July 10th, you get 25% off. If you go March 1st to March 31st, it's 20% off. And then they go down further, like 20% or 15%, depending on the dates for the cabins at Fort Wilderness, Caribbean Beach, Coronado, Port Orleans French, and Riverside. 15 to 10% off, depending on the nights. Bay Lake Tower, All-Star Movies, All-Star Music, All-Star Sports, the Kidani Village and Animal Kingdom Villas, Art of Animation, Contemporary, Pop Century, and the Villas at the Grand Floridian. And then 10% off of campsites at Fort Wilderness.
That's a really good deal. But, well, okay.
Is it, though?
So they knocked the price down to what it would have been probably a year or two.
I mean, it's really not that great of a deal. But you can book those now. If you're an annual pass holder, you can save up to 30% during the spring and summer. The dates for those are May 1st to July 10th. And you have 30% off of, you know, Boulder Ridge, Copper Creek, Animal Kingdom Lodge, Beach Club, Boardwalk Inn, Boardwalk Villa, Coronado Springs, Grand Floridian, Old Key West, Polynesian Village, Riviera, Saratoga Springs, Wilderness Lodge, and Yacht Club. 25% off the cabins at Fort Wilderness, All-Star Sports, Caribbean Beach, Port Orleans, both French and Riverside. 20% Disney's All-Star Movies, All-Star Music, Animal Kingdom Villas, Kidani Village, Art of Animation, Contemporary, Pop Century. 15% off the campsites at Fort Wilderness and the villas at the Grand Floridian. And 10% off of Animal Kingdom Villas, Jamba House.
Okay, well.
That's a lot to say.
That is a lot to say.
I'm talking a lot and I'm starting to be like, eh.
So, look, the takeaway from this is that I don't think the bookings are good. I mean, we saw a lot of kind of fire sales on the Star Wars Galactic Star Cruiser.
Well, we only saw it for people that were like Disney Vacation Club, yeah. DVC people.
Yeah.
So are we going to start seeing that for normal people? Because it's still not doing well.
I think so. I think we will. I think eventually, and this is just my own personal opinion, but I think eventually we're going to see them rethink the entire business model of that. I think they might still do the 2-day excursion or whatever, but I can see them doing just like a day trip. I could see them doing like a dinner theater.
They were testing out, I think, when they did the previews, they were testing out some different ones where it was a 1-day thing.
Do a 1-day thing with original trilogy characters and it's money in the bank.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it is. I mean, charge a couple $100 a person. You're not going to make as much, but it's better than having it sit empty and being a laughing stock, which it is now. Everybody's making fun of how ridiculously overpriced it is and how empty it is.
You really could just do a 1-day, and even just a 1-day, 1-night thing, and it would be, you get all the same stuff. You don't have to go to Galaxy's Edge. You get pretty much the same thing, you know? I don't know. The last thing we're going to talk about is that there is a dining promo card. Now, this is kind of like what they did for UK guests, and we're not getting the dining plan back yet. They promised they said it was coming back, but we haven't gotten it back. We don't have free dining.
Mm-hmm.
We have the promo card. Okay, and it sounds like, wow, up to $750. No, it depends on where you stay and certain dates that you get that much money.
Okay.
So you have to have a 5-night, 4-day vacation package to get this, okay, to get hit up to $750. The offer is valid for most nights June 25th to June 30th, July 1st to July 10th, so over the 4th, June 25th to, wait, I got that again, and August 1st to September 12th. Okay, so we already did that. So it's June through September, depending. Now, here's where it gets interesting and confusing, because Disney's nothing but confusing anymore.
Oh, my God.
So you get up to $150 per night if you stay at the Deluxe Villa Resorts that are listed. Now, you only get the $150 per night for most nights, July 1st to July 10th and August 1st to September 14th. It's only $125 per night for June 25th to June 30th and July 11th to July 31st.
So this is one of the big complaints that they have on a lot of the websites talking about the decline of Disney and why people are opting not to go is how damn confusing
it
Disney
is. And then you have Genie Plus and everything else on there.
Yeah.
Okay, the same rates, $150 for those dates, $125 for those dates for the deluxe resorts that are regular ones. Then we get down to the moderates, and you get up to $100 per room per night for the dates, the July 1st to July 10th, August 1st, September 14th. You get $75 per person per night for the other dates that we talked about, and those for the moderates. Same dates again, value resorts. It's $50 for the first group of nights, $35 for the second group of nights. You know, so you can see the value declines greatly depending on where you stay. So, you know, $750 is very misleading because that's if you come at the peak time and stay at one of the most expensive resorts, and you cannot combine it with any other discount. So if you already have a room discount, you can't have this. You have to pick and choose.
Yeah, a lot of times people said the room discounts actually wind up being better than the dining plan because the rack rate for the rooms are so damn high now that, you know, I mean, I don't know. There's no cheap way to go to Disney. I don't know what to tell you. I would actually say stay at the Good Neighbor hotels. You know, that's your best bet because the rooms are crazy expensive now.
Yeah, it's ridiculous. And they're not worth it, honestly. No, they're not worth it. And I've been in rooms that were like the more expensive rooms, and it was like we were at the Contemporary, and that was before they put the redo, but I think they did most of that on the inside. It was like a really dumpy room for the price. I'm not going to lie. I would not have paid that much had I known that room would have sucked that badly.
We went during the pandemic when they were having some crazy deals and we stayed at the Contemporary. Yeah. And we stayed for the convenience of being able to walk to Magic Kingdom. And then we actually spent a couple days in Universal and we went to Endless Summer and we got a suite there. And we were actually more impressed with the suite at Endless Summer than we were at the room at the Contemporary.
And the Contemporary cost infinitely more money.
Yeah. Yep.
So, I mean, it's all up to your preference because maybe your family has a resort that you always like to stay at because it's like a tradition, things like that. I personally, if I was going to go to a deluxe, I like the beach club. I like the boardwalk. Mm. But you're not in the room much. It's not really worth it.
Yeah, I would. That's what I always tell people. It's like if you're not, you know, staying at the hotel to stay at the hotel and enjoy the hotel, then save money. Because if you're going to be in the parks most of the time anyway, I mean, it's worth paying a little bit more for convenience if you don't want to walk farther or whatever. But, you know, I can't justify if you're barely going to be in the room spending $700, $800, $900 a night. That's ridiculous.
It's ridiculous. So, anyway.
Anyway, that's Disney. That's Disney now.
It is. That's the Disney difference.
Redizulous. Anyway, we're going to wrap this one up. Please subscribe. More podcasts coming. Go to piratesandprincesses.net for more objective Disney and Universal news, and we'll talk later.
Bye.
Asante came to TurboTax after graduating from culinary school and landing a job in the hottest kitchen in town.
My hands are full all day, every day.
I love it.
Asante, as your TurboTax expert, I'll make your moves count, guaranteeing 100% accurate filing and your maximum refund. Sound good?
Yes, expert!
Switch to Intuit TurboTax and make your moves count. See guarantee details at TurboTax.com/guarantees. Experts only available with TurboTax Live.